biggest launch I've ever been involved in.
We were convinced we could do it better than everybody else.
It's a great feeling when you see the first car crash.
Just take a look at these vehicles. They are absolutely state-of-the-art.
VE is a bigger job than even VT was, and VT was the biggest job we'd ever done at Holden Design.
Hi, I'm Mark Scaife.
And I'm Deborah Hutton.
And for the next hour, we're going to take you inside the future of Holden. And Deb, it's going to be a wild ride.
We've been given unprecedented access to secret areas within Holden to see just how the all-new Commodore was developed.
This is a very big story, and the stakes are extremely high. Over $1 billion has been spent to bring Australia the long-awaited new Commodore. Get it wrong, and Commodore loses its number one spot. It's held for over a decade.
Get it right.
And Holden could take this car overseas to international success.
So get ready for an Access All Areas look at the all-new Commodore.
The Commodore VE blasted into the spotlight in Melbourne. The new car prowled down a catwalk-style runway in front of Australia's leading motoring scribes and didn't disappoint.
It's a great styling job, and that's such an important part of the success of any car, is getting the styling right, getting people into the showrooms, based on the hook that the styling gives it. So I think they're off to a great start with it, for sure.
The fact that they're allowed to do it here in Australia says as much as the car itself about where Holden is in the whole GM world these days.
Fantastic looking car. It's got a real hints of European styling to it, but you can look at it straight away and you can tell it's a Commodore.
The Commodore nameplate has a proud history in Australia, and it all started in 1978 when the first Commodore, the VB, rolled off the line. Models and four generations later, Holden has delivered over 2.4 million Commodores to adoring fans in Australia and many places around the world. Dollar Baby, cute name. But this car actually cost over $1 billion, an Australian first, and took 6 years to develop. Well, you'd have to have some pretty good reasons and a bulletproof business plan to ask management for that kind of money.
Our car, the best-selling car still, the Commodore, is 9 years old. There's millions of them out there. We need a new car. We've got to have a car that can compete with anybody in the world. The reality is, you got 50 brands that compete in this market here. It's crazy. It's a million vehicle market.
It was here, in Holden's high security design department, where the first wish list for VE was developed.
Back in 99, Mike Simcoe, who was the director of design at that time, he developed what we call a bill of design. It had all the product attributes that we're actually chasing.
Design staff, I think, gave the engineers some challenges, that's for sure. But I'd have to say, when I first saw the car in the studio, I was fairly impressed with Mike's work.
The main things we were looking at in 1998 going forward were the need for greater safety levels in the car. That was really the overriding one, I think, from a legislative point of view. And also from a customer expectation point of view.
It all starts with a sketch, and essentially that sketch then becomes a living document for the rest of the organisation to actually use as a guide in terms of where the car needs to go from a design perspective, from a styling perspective.
Marketing is the voice of the customer, is responsible for getting that research and to make sure that we've built that in from the very first design sketch to ensure that we really meet and, most importantly, exceed customers' expectations.
The reality is, we can't rely on just being the Aussie car anymore.
we've got to have a car that can compete with anybody in the world. You know, 70%+ of the cars in this market are import. They come from everywhere around the world. So we've got to be as good or better than these imports.
Thousands of two- and three-dimensional digital impressions examined every panel and plane, both inside and out. But management needed to see this car life-size. And some simple Aussie ingenuity showed how the VE would be dramatically different from VT way back in 1999. In the end, a simple slideshow demonstrated bold new plans for VE.
So the red car was a fine example of, I guess, the creativity from my group. First of all, we moved the front wheels forward. We then moved the rear wheels rearward. We then showed lifting the belt line and the effect it had on the appearance of the car. And then we looked at the occupant package in relation to the overall size and mass of the car and the fact where they were the same. And finally, we showed where the emerging proportions were heading with a final slide, which looked at what we saw as a VE proportion. And then we can then relate that to what was now the emerging sketch program.
As chief designer, the focus is to harness the energies of our creative guys. There's no shortage of talent in our department. So we were putting up their hand pretty quickly, telling me that I can design the next VE Commodore. So from there, we let the designers loose. We wind them up, let them go, express themselves.
Because we had a new architecture this time and we knew we were getting a new architecture, we pushed the envelope even harder with what we wanted to deliver. When we launched the VT back in the late 90s, it was a huge success. And then that was followed up by the coupe show car and then ultimately the Monaro production car. And there was other show cars in between, so all of a sudden, Holden Design had this reputation of putting out good design, not just here, but globally.
While design was busy sketching, the engineers couldn't wait. Using this old VT Commodore, they cobbled together a basic version of the new suspension and steering setup to see how it would work. Essentially, this is the first VE.
Ride and handling are part of what Holden does. And we felt that with the previous suspension, we'd gone as far as we could, and now we needed to make a big jump, an architectural change, a real move forward. What a present. Don't often get one like that from design staff. They gave us something where they'd stretched the wheelbase, and they'd made the overhang on the front really short so that the engine was inside the wheelbase. Yay! You know, now we've got somewhere where we can put mass inside the wheelbase. We've got larger wheels on this car as well, and we're thinking handling, fantastic. Everything we wanted, really.
The first cars we drove at the proving ground were pretty rough. I think in driving it, people started to feel that we did have something special here, and this was going to work out to be a car that was, where we wanted it to be. It was going to be a superior driving experience. I think it showed the first glimmer of substantial hope for that.
After the break, we see the clay model that gives Holden its first real look at the new car.
CSI Sunday from 8:30.
Nothing gives designers a feel for dimension and form like the clay. A sculpture of metal and high-tech mud finally gives Holden their first look at the new car.
The process of going from sketch to clay is probably the most challenging and hardest part of our process. A lot of people can capture the essence of a car in 2D sketch or Photoshop, but the real trickery and beauty behind good car design is taking that 2D to 3D. Why does a car look good and another car doesn't? That's behind the development in the clay.
Really, we didn't see this until March 2001, where we really framed up the scales, but we funneled all the scales down to two. And then from around March 2001, we took those scales and we brought them up into full-size clays. We ran clinics on the scale model development and we ran clinics on the full-size as well. So we're constantly checking right through the process to ensure that we're on the mark in terms of delivering a car that will be truly aspirational.
I can sit beside a clay model for hours on end with my modellers working on one small portion of the car until we get it right, and we don't stop till we get it right. So it's a very long process. I mean, we are known for being pains in the ass till we get things right.
Virtual reality is the latest tool in the arsenal of high-tech gadgets that develop Holden's new models. While traditional sculpting techniques produce clay models, 3D programmers use complex number sequences to create contrasting views of the cars that will soon become a reality. Virtual reality, or visualization, has been involved since the start of the program. As the clay modelling program continues, Holden, using its new math-led process, begins to build a computer file that will eventually become the new Commodore. This file is shared by all the departments working on it simultaneously. Designers using technology borrowed from the film industry constantly finesse the outside sheet metal. As the exterior shape develops, engineers work on the structures beneath. As engineering design and redesign their components, manufacturing also looks at how parts can be made and then fitted on the production line. The constant sharing of information speeds up the development process, which allowed more designs to be explored and more ideas to be tested. Holden need to address any issues so that when they fully produce what they call a physical property, it's absolutely right. And that property we're talking about is an actual car. At the end of this process, there are some massive computer files that are virtually the new Commodore. The next step in the process is hand-building prototype Commodores.
There are thousands of parts that go together to make up the new Commodore. Each of them have been designed and tested for quality and durability, till finally everyone's happy. Late in 2004, the design was frozen. Both internal and external suppliers then got busy making small numbers of parts so the very first prototype cars could be built by hand.
These prototype cars are some of the most expensive cars in the world. Why? Because they're made up of thousands of one-off parts. These cars teach manufacturing how they need to be assembled, how the thousands of parts make up a Commodore fit each other. They allow manufacturing to establish the best ergonomic way for employees to fit that part. As the first cars grow, all the systems and procedures will be fine-tuned so when workers build these cars online, they'll be safe from injury. They'll be in the right position with the right tool to fit that part precisely. Quality is based on every part being exactly right on every job. The giant Commodore jigsaw puzzle grows more complete each day as the departments patiently wait for their allocated prototypes to begin the testing phase called validation. Some of the first hand-built Commodores were sent to the high-speed tracks in Mesa, Arizona. But Holden takes full advantage of Australia's outback, one of the world's best naturally occurring car testing resources. Holden take millions of dollars of test equipment into the red dust of northern Australia and hammer these prototypes relentlessly.
If we test out to 50 degrees plus, we know that all our customers will be satisfied with the drivability and the startability of the cars under the most extreme conditions that they personally experience.
Commodores are sold in markets like the Middle East, where temperatures often reach into the 40s. Add this to speed limits that are far more liberal than Australia's, and our export Holdens are up for a pretty hot and hard time. No, there's no new Commodore plan here. That PT stands for powertrain, some makeshift badging to confuse the spies.
While cars are out doing their hard yards in the heat and dust of outback Australia, laboratories at Fisherman's Bend run engines for thousands of hours, flat out, till they glow red hot. Hour after grueling hour, these engines tow loads equivalent to the biggest trailers for days on end, non-stop. There's no pull over and have a rest, like in the real world. It's flat out till engineers achieve the best performance figures versus fuel economy. Fuel economy is the holy grail of the engine group.
If you test in the heat, you must also test in the cold. So the team headed to the Alps in Victoria's high country. Clad in elaborate camouflage suits to protect their identity, cars sit for hours idling in the rarefied atmosphere of this alpine facility. They then launch themselves down this high-altitude 2.5-kilometre airstrip. And because it's a closed road, engineers can drive and monitor computers collecting data as they read engine information from a massive sensors attached to the engines of these secret cars. After the break, Mark will take us behind the walls of Holden's high-security proving ground, and we'll see the early Commodore prototypes tortured in ways you won't believe. Thank goodness car testing technology has advanced in parallel with the car building technology. This Lang Lang archival footage from the 70s shows just how far we've come.
This is Holden's top secret proving ground at Lang Lang in Victoria. Its road network is about 44 kilometres long, and it replicates some of Australia's toughest and demanding roads. These are the sorts of roads that the engineers need to torture the new Commodores.
Water baths and mud test seals. Cobblestones and corrugation hammer suspension systems. Test vehicles repeat thousands of controlled circuits. The banked high-speed loop allows these new Commodores to maintain extremely high speeds for hours. All in the name of testing. The torturing accelerates time. One day's testing can equal a month of normal driving. But the torture isn't restricted to driving. Engineers chill cars to minus 40 degrees in giant deep freezers just because a Commodore customer, somewhere in the future, might be exposed to these extreme temperatures.
This is part of Holden's crash test laboratories. These engineers are poring over the wreckage of a million-dollar prototype from barrier test 819. It is one of the earliest crash tests of a hand-built VE body shell, and the safety engineers are finding out if the computer simulations got it right. They pretty well knew what would happen when this VE slammed into the concrete barrier at 56 kilometres per hour because they'd been slamming virtual VEs into walls for years. This was the acid test, when all the predictions are proved or disproved in a real simulation.
We had a very positive test result, which is always good to know that all those years of work on the computer models had actually paid off, but also to have a look at the car and see the real performance. We have a number of post-teardown type activities that go on, both removing the parts off the car and looking at the structural deformation, checking the integrity of the electrical system and actually going through the structure. And by the time we'd taken everything off it, we got a real good look at how that structure was actually performing, which for us was a great validation of all the work we'd done on the computer-generated models. We knew we'd created something that really was special.
Increased levels of safety were always a priority for the new Commodore. A major part of the VE program was to make curtain airbags available for the first time.
We're all very pleased to be able to add a roof rail curtain airbag to the VE Commodore range. It's something that we've wanted to put on the vehicle, but there's a lot of work under the surface to get those things into a car. It's not the sort of technology you could just turn on. The car has to be designed for it, and the structure has to be capable of using it. And also you need a sensing system that we've now employed to be able to fire those airbags accurately when they're needed.
And if you add a curtain side airbag, you need to prove it.
The highly trained barrier test engineers set up all the ingredients for a simulated collision with a telegraph pole or tree. Crash test dummies from children to large adults are strapped in, and cameras that scream at an incredible 1,000 frames per second are loaded and focused. The sled that will propel this car into the pole is sent back to the start position, and everything is ready. Lights, cameras, action. Every angle is covered, giving us a dramatic view of the simulation. The airbags deploy as designed and dummies are checked for damage. The new curtain airbag is available on all models of the Commodore, adding a major new item to an already long list of safety features on board.
So you can see here that the curtain is deployed. We can see on the other side that there's a paint mark from the dummy's head on the airbag, which shows that we've got a good restraint of the occupant's head. This is the first time we've run the pole impact on the VE. As you can see, everything's worked well.
Side curtain airbag testing continued along with a demolition derby of crashing, including oblique, under truck. Front airbags are now two-stage in Commodore. This advancement detects the size of the occupant, position of the seat, and the severity of the impact, then instantly adjusts the degree of inflation. And when they ran out of things to crash into, things crashed into it.
It's July 2005, and stakeholders from all departments descend on the proving ground. They're here to check on progress, and they check everything. This is one tough audience. Panel gaps and door catches are scrutinised. No one's pulling punches. With just over 12 months to launch, is the project on track? Will the promised quality be delivered? Secrecy is still paramount, and the prototypes are still camouflaged despite being driven in this top secret facility.
There's been a lot of work done to get to this stage in terms of the analysis, but it's very pleasing to find that the actual product is delivered to the performance that we wanted to achieve.
The cars should feel like they're carved out of a bit of stone, as in road feel, and I think they deliver it.
It's just extremely responsive. It just does exactly what the driver wants to do, and there's just no surprises anywhere.
With still more work to do in refining the car, they head out on yet more loops of the proving ground rough tracks. And this is not all about the mechanics of the car. It's tuning those noise levels inside the cabin, it's seat comfort, it's testing if the CD skips when the car hits a pothole. Nothing is left untested. But there's only so much you can do with test drivers, so Holden developed a test rig that didn't need one. This rough track simulator in Holden's laboratories punishes the whole body shell, and it can do it around the clock. They've even built rigs that specifically hammer sub-assemblies, like the cockpit, the diff, and the rear suspension, with loads equal to the roughest tracks in the world. If you've built a reputation on building tough cars for a tough country, you've got to be able to prove it.
Coming up, the bit I've been waiting for, the interior designs for Holden's new baby. Well, Mark, it's been a great ride so far, but of course there's plenty more to see.
There sure is, Deborah. There's a great story coming up about how Holden build these cars. You know, they spent nearly $500 million on redesigning the plant in Adelaide.
Which is a huge amount of money. And you're going to demonstrate a fantastic new safety feature, which is just amazing.
Plus, there's a behind-the-scenes look at shooting the new launch television commercials.
But first, let's see how Holden comes up with their fabulous interior designs.
Holden presents a real challenge to interior designers. The product ranges from entry-level Amiga to the luxury of Calais, through to the new high-profile sports SSV. Each of these levels must have their own character and style.
One of our major functions is to ensure that we create the emotional canvas that's laid onto each of the surfaces. We looked at fashion design, interior design, architecture, product design and nature. We wanted the product to have a real presence, to have a wow factor about it. We need to make sure that we're going to hit the sweet spot for each of our customers. SSV is all about, look at me, we've got the hero colour inside the car now, as well as outside of the car, so this is a strong statement on the road. The car is for a driver that has an expressive style. Not only does it deliver in performance, but it delivers in hotwood looks as well.
With only 1 month before production commences, there's time for one final trip to Mount Isa and Alice Springs to sign off on suspension.
We want to evaluate all the different suspension packs while we're out here, just to make sure that we've done a good job and the cars are performing as we want them to in this environment. We want the car to handle anything that the road can put up to it, really, in terms of bumps. You know, I don't think that you should have to slow down in a sports car because the road has turned a little bit rough. It needs to be able to handle that.
VE Commodore will end up travelling over 3.4 million kilometres before engineers finally stop refining and adjusting the new car. This is the most tested Commodore ever.
The massive quality leap demanded for the car meant a major refit to Holden's Adelaide manufacturing plant.
We couldn't afford and can't afford to take the plant down, you know, for a month or 2 months to retool it, you know. So we had to retool on the fly. So if you went from the start, the beginning of the plant and the beginning of the body shop, all the way through paint, all the way through general assembly, basically in the last 3 years, it's been all been redone.
Over $500 million has been spent on equipping the facility ready for the future.
The robot population swelled by a massive 188 new machines. Servo weld guns were introduced to increase the accuracy and quality of the joins.
And a giant rig was commissioned to handle the huge one-piece body side. Massive new presses were installed to handle the new high-strength steels, now in VE. A skillet system was installed to allow workers to travel along with the moving cars as they build them. The ergonomic benefits immediately translate into quality improvements. Holden has redesigned the workflow in the Adelaide plant so that entire sections of the new car are assembled off the main line. This process allows subsections like the engine and transmission and front and rear suspension to be constructed on rigs that give world-class tolerances and build quality demanded for VE. These giant building blocks then come together seamlessly on the line. Car shells seem to envelop entire engines and powertrains in a single gulp.
The same process has been applied to the front-end module of the new Commodore. Precise rigs allow the front of the new Holden to be built up as a single part and then attached to the body in one single operation. The same system sees fully built up doors glide in on cue to marry with the waiting body. The plan was to move Adelaide's Elizabeth plant up to the next level to a facility of international quality. $500 million well spent.
We actually describe it as a symphony. At the end of the day, you are trying to ensure that all of the elements come together and to make beautiful music.
ESP stands for Electronic Stability Program. This is fantastic technology that, believe me, will help to avoid crashes.
But the best way to help you understand it is to show you a demonstration. We have switched the ESP off. In a scenario played out on roads around the world, something unexpected gets in your way and you need to steer around it, where you can see what happens. When ESP is switched on, the car, through a number of sensors, will detect imminent skidding. In a split second, ESP applies brake pressure to the appropriate wheel. It can even adjust engine power if needed. Now let's do that again with ESP switched on. Same driver, car, speed and conditions. How good is that? The car goes exactly where it's pointed and the problem is avoided. This state-of-the-art safety system is standard on all new VE Commodore sedans, which is a first for an Australian car maker.
Not many people could say they've got a better job than me, but let me introduce you to Rob Tribbiani from Holden Engineering.
Before Rob hammers this SSV around Phillip Island, engineers loaded up with very expensive monitoring equipment to record a host of engine and transmission information. This is Holden's absolute last chance to find any niggles or do any tweaks before full production begins. So hold on to your hat.
Blasting down the front straight at over 220 kilometres an hour. Coming into turn one, give the brake pedal a little nudge, turn the car in, the car gets on its line really quickly. There's very little body roll in this car.
The racetrack offers Rob a chance to safely do laps at what we race drivers call 10 tenths. Flat out with ESP switched off. The car is deliberately forced to step out on corners to test its ability to recover, and it's rock steady.
Car on change of direction is rock solid. The car's light on its feet, easy to throw around.
The brakes are punished in ways not possible anywhere except on a closed racetrack. The test day dramatically proving Commodore's engineering credentials.
The car probably even outperformed what we thought it was going to today. I mean, the car has been fantastic during its development, and we always knew that it was going to be good, but this good, yeah, I think it's even taken us by surprise today.
After the break, Holden comes up with an idea big enough to launch its most important car ever.
Bigger. Prehistoric Park. Continue Sunday on Win.
The Commodore is good to go for launch. Years of work perfecting every aspect of the car has come down to this. No time for nerves, Holden holds its breath, and the launch begins.
Holden's top dealers from around Australia and New Zealand gathered on the Gold Coast to see the new car. Mobile phones were confiscated as they entered the auditorium, but not for the usual good manners reason. The reveal of the cars was to be very explosive, with a wall of glass shattering at the climax of a driving music and light show, and a mobile phone could accidentally trigger it early. Inside, last-minute preparations calmly proceed.
Sheets are quite large. They're 3.2 metres tall. The stage is flexing, the weight of the glass. You don't want the sheets to bang into each other end to end, even though the glass is five times stronger than normal. It's weakest on its end. And the explosives, being explosives, you've got to be nice to those and give them due respect.
All the rehearsals are done. Last-minute checks complete. It's showtime.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am honoured to present
the all-new Caprice and the all-new Commodore.
With their ears still ringing, the dealers headed to Norwell for their chance to drive the new Commodore at the Holden Performance Driving Centre. It wasn't long before they really got things pumping with the VE range. Putting it through its paces, it was an enthusiastic first meeting and may have even been love at first drive.
Lovely car. Absolutely very impressed.
One of the most unbelievable cars you could ever want to drive.
Already sold, so it's done. I'll have this one.
Then it's Australia's motoring journalist's turn to get behind the wheel. After a sedate drive from Melbourne to the Holden Proving Ground, these usually mild-mannered reporters use the various closed roads and skid pans to really get to know Holden's latest offering. Hard acceleration and braking were followed by an in-depth investigation of ESP on some muddy roads. An impressive demonstration of the high-tech safety system. The Australian public will get its first mass viewing of Holden's pride and joy with the TV commercial. We were there in a quarry on the New South Wales south coast to see the launch television commercial being filmed.
The client said to us, forget what driving means now. You know, forget everything you know about driving. This will change the way you think about it. Like, this is a whole new driving experience.
What is now is sort of a thing of the past, so therefore the Stone Age that we've recreated is sort of, a visual way of saying that is sort of history and everything will change from this point on.
This is high-end commercial production that has to cut through the advertising clutter. The Hollywood-style film crew shot for days to showcase the stunning SSV in a make-believe Stone City. Here now is the finished commercial that will announce the arrival of Holden's all-new Commodore.
It's the dawn of a new age in driving. Introducing the all-new Holden Commodore. Designed from the word go to be one of the most exciting cars in the world, with linear control suspension and electronic stability program for added safety. So after 6 years and over $1 billion, it leaves the competition in the Stone Age. The all-new Holden Commodore. Go like never before.
What's 55 metres long, has a giant TV screen, contains around 5 million litres of helium, oh, and it's red all over? The Holden airship.
The enormous airship was secretly constructed in Melbourne's largest aircraft hangar over a period of 6 weeks. Once inflated, the six-person gondola was attached and the mighty ship was ready for the daunting task of applying signage. Large cherry pickers worked around the clock to add the Holden livery, and then the light sign was attached. 369,600 LEDs illuminate the world's largest airborne TV screen, measuring a massive 12.3 metres long and 9.1 metres high, the screen visible from a distance of 1 kilometre. It's Holden's plan to expose the whole of Australia to its brand new publicity device over the next 12 months. It's a really big idea for a really big Holden launch.
Love the game.
Well, the new Commodore is built, launched, and soon you'll be able to drive one for yourself.
But Deb, there's one more thing. A new race car is underway, but it's still under wraps.
Oh.
But someone from Holden threw the keys to some of my mates recently.
Your mates?
No, racing mates.
That should be interesting.
This is a good car, let me tell you.
It's the first time I've seen the car, and just blown away.
I love that Calais, I'll be honest with you. I thought that was a beautiful car, that.
That is a grouse car.
Power on. Absolutely superb.
I reckon salesmen will be made redundant. Like, the cars will just shove themselves.
Don't worry, mate. Here's the check.
Where do I sign?
Yeah. Good way to start the day with a few circles before you go to work.
This may be one of the best jobs in the company, if not in the world. I mean, it's if you like cars, there's not a much better job than this job.
Our customers will love the performance improvements.
It's fairly true to say that anybody can buy a robot these days. It's what you get out of it that counts, and really that's all about what people and their ingenuity have brought to the party. I absolutely know that they're proud of this car.
We had a whole lot of engineers who thought they were kids in a toy shop. It's not often that we start from absolutely scratch and build the exact car that we wanted. Well, this is the exact car that we wanted to build.
I'm very proud of the car. I think the whole Holden team has to be extremely proud of the car. It really is an amazing achievement.
When I was at the dealer launch, it was an amazing experience. One dealer actually gave me a hug, which I'll take as he was pretty happy with the design of the car.
This car has exceeded our expectations.
I passionately believe that the VE is the finest car that's ever been designed, engineered, and manufactured in Australia. It's now game on.
This Commodore is Holden's baby, and it's like it's got 8,000 or 9,000 parents, very proud parents.
I think in many ways Holden has now started to reach its full potential, and we can see just what we're capable of, and that the sky's the limit from here.
We set a vision from the start. We chased that vision with a passion, with an obsession.
The net result is a car that is truly world class.
I think it's just the reaction of people saying, I love this car, I want this car, I've got to have this car is all about me.
I think without a doubt everybody saw these cars and said, wow, look at those cars.
So there it is. Over $1 billion and hundreds of thousands of people hours later, Australia and the world has its all-new Holden Commodore.
It's safer, more dynamic, and more refined to world-class standards. It carries the pride of thousands of Holden staff who have lived and breathed this project for 6 years.
We've seen how a single vision has inspired engineers, designers, and manufacturers to go to dizzy new heights and build the car they've always wanted to build.
All new Commodore is go.
And we're gone.
Bye for now.
How good is the car?
Oh, it's fantastic.
Yeah, you're talking.